I've been doing this stuff close to 20 years. Probably diagnosed, I was counting the other night, close to 60,000 cars. And I'm going to tell you, I still see new problems today. Every single week there's new problems coming. So you can't use a tactic that, well, it's probably the same problem. It could be similar, but not the same. So you just have to watch out your tactics. So here I am trying to present 10 case studies to show you what happens along the way, and just put a little theory in it too to make it a little interesting, and just see what you guys would do, guys and girls would do, if you come across these particular problems. I want to clarify one thing here, because I put the word out in the class, and one of my garages, John, is this a big joke? I said, what are you talking about, dude? He goes, I went out to TST seminars and stuff out there, and there's automotive stuff, but there's something else going on. I said, what are you talking about? I says, TSTseminars.com? I think it's .org. So I go out there myself, and I'm looking at this thing, and I'm like, online computer training, auto repair, network security, seminars, erectile dysfunction. I'm like, hey, gee, didn't you own that site at one time? So he sold out on us. So I don't know what happened there. So I'm thinking to myself, what does that have to do with anything with automotive? I'm just beside myself. I'm like, you know what? I'm going to turn this whole thing around. I know what it's all about. Learning creates excitement. And that's what it is. It's the fact when you keep learning about cars, it creates excitement. I've been in shops where, you know, I diagnose something, I get all excited. Because, you know, I found the problem, I worked up to it, and then I'm like, I give the guy a tech hug. I'm like, dude, tech hug. You ever see Austin Powers? The guy goes, tucka, 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 tucka. Come on. He gives him a tech hug. It creates excitement when you can have a car come in, you diagnose it, you pinpoint it to just one part, and that's what it is. That's what creates excitement. Just plugging a part and saying, let me just try this, that's not excitement. Because that could be a big problem. So I think that's there for creating excitement by teaching. It's the learning curve that creates excitement. So it was pretty cool that I saw that, but I had to clarify. It's TSTseminars.org, not com. I get that out of the way. Our first victim here is a 2007 Jeep Grand Cherokee. And the guy hired me because he had a no start, no communication errors. And he said, I got an ECM for it, and I want you to come and program it. So I can go to the shop either as a salesman, so I put the salesman hat on, or I can go there as a diagnostician. But when he does put the computer in and buys one, I always try to interrogate him a little bit before he goes to buy one, just to make sure he made the right decision. Because I don't want to go there and have to program it and go, well, guess what? That wasn't the problem. So what are we going to do now? So I take the salesman hat off. I put the technician hat on. I'm like, you know what? Let's just diagnose this car, figure out what it is. Because if we figure out what it is, we can at least bury this thing. Because here's the problem. Once you buy that part, you know what happens? You're married. This ring goes on. And I got news for you. If it comes off, it's a terrible, terrible divorce. A lot of money. I mean, we're talking a $600 computer. You can't say to Ms. Jones, well, you know what? I didn't fix your car. We're going to tow it out. And by the way, here's a $600 computer. Can you take that with you? It doesn't work that way. So once we buy it, we're married. The ring stays on. We're going to be married to the car. So we have no choice but to figure out what the problem is. We're going to have to. So you could see that over here, that's his new computer he put in place. And when I attached it, I still had no communication. So I'm like, dude, let me just educate you on something. That if you buy a new computer and you plug it in, it doesn't communicate, that's not your problem. Because I can't program it if it doesn't communicate. Because all computers come with some type of software, so it will talk to the scan tool so I can go in and program it. So if it doesn't communicate after you put it in, that's not the problem. So I'm not going to compound my diagnosis hooking up a new computer because that guy needs a lot of stuff to get him going. So what I did was I said, you know what? Let's plug in the old computer and let's just find out what's going on here. Because the easiest way to start your diagnosis is with your scan tool, you should go out to all the computers on the network, all of them, every one of them. to see who's talking, who's not talking. Because how do you know it's not your scan tool not talking to everybody? It could be. So, and then also, too, is you want to see if the other computers see that that guy's a problem on the network. Right? So all you can do is you're going to plug in and just see if you can talk to validate your tool. Another thing, too, you can do is, you know, there's two ways to go into the computer. You can go in through factory side by putting year, make, model, engine, the whole nine yards, or you can go to over to generic. Because you don't know if someone put a wrong year computer in there, so your ID and your scan tool to talk to that car for that year, make, model, and they won't talk because it's ID wrong. But OB2 generic will always talk to that car. So I always tell guys, go in both ways, generic and factory. But obviously, it's no communication, no start, so chances are it's not his tool. So I hook this computer in. I want to make my checks. And I want to show you what... I have 20 factory scan tools. I can tell you that just about every manufacturer, except for GM, they're a little behind. They've done it only for 2010 only. Every manufacturer is now PC-based with an interface. Every single one of them. All went PC-based because that's where they're going. And I'll show you one of the reasons. Chrysler right now has done the best job. I'm going to show you what they've done. This is called topology. And what they're doing, this is not my projector, so I'm trying to get used to it. What they're doing is pretty unique is they lay out all the computers in relationship to where they're located in the car, which I think is a great idea. And Nissan's doing this a little bit, but not as good as these guys. And there's a few other companies, but right now Chrysler has got it down to a science. I mean, look at this. You see these little lightning bolts here? A little green lightning bolt? Now, I'm online, by the way, because you have to be online with a lot of these scan tools. And the reason being is, what do you think this little lightning bolt is on this computer? I'm on Chrysler's network with the tool. A flash. It's telling you that there's a flash file available for that computer if you want to download it. How cool is that? Not only that, see the guys in blue? The guys in blue, they're okay. There's no codes in them. The guys in gray are not even on the car. You see how it's their options. It knows by VIN that those computers are not on board. And the reason why I like that is I can hook up a Nissan scanner, like the Nissan scanner, and it'll go in and ping all the modules, and only like five show up. Meanwhile, I'm like, there's seven there. Why would only five? So it only shows you the guys that are there. It doesn't show you the guys who are not there and say, no communication, no communication. But Chrysler shows you them all, and look at this. You see the guys in red? They left town. I can tell you by looking at this map, the ABS computer's dead, the trans computer's dead, the PCM is dead. Now, do you think we have three bad computers at the same time? So should we replace all three of those computers? Do you think that they have a common network branch? They could. Could it be severed? Possibly. Do you think they have a common ground? Do you think they have a common power? So I'm thinking, you know what? And here's the thing. If you went in with your scan tool, I know you don't have this one, but if you went in your scan tool, well, I can't talk to the ABS. I can't talk to the trans. I can't talk to the engine. So dot the I's and cross the T's. Find out what they all have in common. Now you have to get a wiring diagram and compare what they share, which I'm going to show down the line on other case studies. So I went after the easiest one, which is the PCM, because I know that with Chrysler, they always use one battery feed, one ignition feed, and they'll use two main grounds on most of their computers. So how easy to go like this with a test site? Ground, battery, ignition. That's not too hard. But you want to do it at the computer. You don't want to do extremity checking and start checking off fuses because there's no guarantee that that fuse is reaching that computer. I've had many, many cases where the wire, you check the fuse is good. And you're like, well, I checked all the fuses, so it's got to be the computer. But meanwhile, the wire goes underneath the battery tray or wherever it's going to go, and it's broken. It's corroded. It never reached the ECM. So you can't validate any of your checks by just checking fuses all the time. There's no guarantee. It's a place to start. You may find a bad fuse, but it's not a valid check before you condemn it. So you know what? I'm going to go after this guy. That's what I'm going to go after right now. So I'm going to do my power check. And here's another thing, too. We talked about U-codes. Remember I said go into all the computers and check for U-codes? Look at this. Well, I got to use this thing. All right. You see how this Electronic selector module, you know, a lot of these shifters now, Mercedes uses them, Chrysler's using them, all right? They're actually computers now. So if you replace the selector module, sometimes the car won't even move. The shifter won't move until you actually program it. That's actually a computer. So electronic shifter computer saying, hey, I can't talk to the ABS module. It's a U code. Like, if you see a U code in that module, don't go diagnosing that module. It's a U code is a pointing finger code. It's like, how you doing? How you doing? How you doing? It's a U code. So it's a code that's a point. It's a finger pointing code. So this guy's complaining the ABS is not talking. This other computer, there's a lot of acronyms in this business. I forgot what FDCM is. I know it's not a front control module. Here's the front control module and gateway module integrated together. But this FDCM is saying, I can't talk to the ECM. And by the way, there's so many acronyms. You need a book. I had a guy yesterday call me, says, John, I got a BSM light on. BSM light? He goes, yeah, well, we worked on the car. It's at a body shop. It's a 2010 Mazda. He goes to me, the BSM light's on. BSM. He goes, what do you think that is? I don't know. Bullshit module? I don't know. I never heard that in my whole life. I said, do me a favor. Go in the manual, the owner's manual. Go look it up and let me know what it is. I'll tell you what I can work on. I don't know what it is. I'll be honest with you. Calls me an hour later. I'm going in tomorrow morning. He goes to me, I call the dealership up, and it's a blind side module. I'm like, what? He goes, they said that's me programmed. I'm like, program? He goes, well, I changed the module in the bumper, and they're telling me that that module was a blind side module. So now there's a module in the bumper on each side. I mean, what happened to this? I mean, I could do that. Now they got a module doing it, for God's sake. A blind side module. So I got to go to tomorrow, and I have to just crash course it right there. So it's a never-ending learning curve. You better look up these acronyms and find out what they're all about. Because what relates to one car is not going to relate to the next car. So that'll be my new case study for tomorrow. Blind side module. So all these U codes are telling me, look, your scanner's not the only one that has a problem. We see it also. So that's the good thing about checking the whole, just check all the modules. I tell guys all the time, check all the modules, go with all, write down all the codes in each module. Then lay them on a map, dot the I's and cross the T's. That's how you fix cars. So with that, the one thing I have to concentrate on before we do all these case studies is, you know, I go over this all the time. You have to know what feeds the computers. And I don't care what kind of computer you're working on. I don't care if it's ABS, airbag. I don't care what it is. Every computer is going to get a battery feed. And it's for memory. So when you shut the car off, it retains information about the car, no matter what module it's going to be for. You're also going to have ignition feed. It's the wake-up call. You turn the key on, computer wakes up. Thank you. It wakes up. It's looking around. It needs that to wake itself up. That can be done two ways. Through ignition switch, direct through a fuse, or through a relay. If it's done through a relay, I'm going to tell you right now, you better check these relays. Because if you hear a click, there's no guarantee it's fully latching. There's no guarantee you're getting full voltage. I had a 2005 Nissan Pathfinder, I think it was, where these idiots took a power relay and fed the computer with it. And they also fed the coils with it. So when I turned the car wouldn't start. It would attempt to start, dead. The guy said one day he got in, went to turn it, wouldn't start no more. So I hooked up my scanner, turned the key on, and it's talking. My scanner's talking. I went to crank the car, it stopped talking. I'm like, it stopped talking. So I'm like, it must have lost power. I'm thinking. And then I got a wiring diagram, I checked my power feed. When I went to crank, it went to like 5 volts. What happened was, these idiots fed the coils the same feed. So when the coils went to fire, they drew all the power away from the ECM and said, hey, dude, we're getting the bigger piece of the pie. You're getting nothing. So all it was a stupid relay. That's all it was. So understand, relays are common, very common failure after a period of time. Also, engine grounds, very critical. You need to check all the grounds, not just one ground and say, all right, well, I checked the ground, I'm happy. I found out through the years that I never knew that each ground is dedicated for a certain job. Do you know they can have one ground just to feed solenoids? Let's say a solenoid has to be grounded. If that one ground going to the ECM is bad, it'll have trouble grounding the solenoids. So if you get solenoid codes, you better make sure you check the grounds at the ECM. Also, look at this. Injector driver. I had a car one time that had four grounds on the starter. So the guy was doing a had four grounds near the starter harness. The guy pulled down the starter, and he was changing the wire on it. I guess when he pulled on it, it broke one wire off the ground because it was a ground strap. Well, it was a common ground holding four wires together right by the starter. He hung the starter work on it. He put it back up, and the car wouldn't start no more. It had no injector pulse. So I'm checking. I thought I checked all the grounds, but I didn't. I checked a couple. And I checked battery, ignition, I had communication, I checked for wide open throttle, TPS. I could ground the injectors at the ECM, but they wouldn't work. So I'm like, look, I checked everything. I checked all the sensor values. I checked crank sensor, cam sensor. I even did the old GM, you scratch test the purple white wire, the RPM signal. No injector pulse. I'm like, dude, the ECM. So he buys an ECM. Guess what happened? I got married. And I went over this car time and time again. And I called my buddy at the dealership. He goes, John, do you know that there's an injector ground? I said, what are you talking about? He goes, yeah, there's an injector ground in that car. GM used it for years. So I look, and there was the one wire broke right off. I could not believe it. So keep in mind, when you're checking grounds, check every single ground. Don't leave no ground untouched. Another thing, too, is power feeds. Do you know that I added these two in? You know, I published and wrote this book. It took me 1,500 hours. Did it a few years back. 1,500 hours it took me to do this book. And at that time, you know, there wasn't stuff like throttle bodies, you know, electronic throttle bodies. And what they're doing now is they're actually feeding a dedicated fuse, a throttle body fuse, right to the ECM. And when that throttle body has a problem or something that jams or whatever, it pops the fuse. So then the guy gets a throttle body code. And he goes, all right, well, I checked all the wiring between the computer and the throttle body, and it's good. And I'm not going to go after a computer, but I think it's the throttle body. So he puts the throttle body on. Same codes. Now he's ready to go for a computer. I'm like, dude, you know what? That's power fed. So it could be a bad driver inside ECM, but the driver may be getting power from somewhere else. I don't know. And it was a blown fuse. It's all it was. Popped. And Honda does the same thing with their solenoids and the transmissions. They're power fed. When you find devices that are power fed, usually there's a protection device going into the ECM. So here's a guy gets a code for solenoid 1, solenoid 2, solenoid 3, or A, B, and C. Three solenoid errors, right? So he checks the wires from the trans to the computer. They're all good. He energizes solenoids. He goes, well, puts a trans in it. Didn't fix it. So when I got there, I'm checking it. I'm like, I don't get this. I don't think it's an ECM. I just never saw one of these ECMs go bad, you know? And I looked at the wiring diagram, and I saw something on the diagram that said, BSOL, battery for the solenoid feed. I'm like, let me go check it. No power at the ECM. It's a blown fuse. So even though the car runs, it doesn't mean there's not a blown fuse somewhere. So understand that you just get in the habit of checking all powers and grounds, all of them, at the ECM. Voltage drop test. This is pretty cool. Voltage drop test. It sounds so like high tech. People are like, oh, what's a voltage drop test? What is that? It's when you take a volt and you drop it like this. Oops. Voltage drop test. I'm going to make it so easy. All you got to do is take your voltmeter. There's no lie. You're creating, you're a bridge. You're counting electrons. Electrons are supposed to go from the battery negative to the engine, right? That's where they should go. So this guy, which was amazing to me, he had a slow cranking engine. That's a brand new battery. And it still has the plastic, how you doing on it? Let's see. Interesting. Still has the plastic, how you doing on it? It's wrapped real nice. See it? See the little bubbles there? That's the wrap. Brand new starter. And it cranks a little slow. And it set an O2 code, by the way. O2 signal high. The first person that will start screaming about a ground problem is always the O2. Because the O2s work 0 to 1 volt. Everything else works a little higher. So if an O2 goes from, if O2 elevates here, you know what? Here. I put all my little gadgets today. Bink. Let's say 5 volts. All right? I just elevated myself to 6 volts. Am I still 5 volts? Am I still 5 volts? I didn't change. I just elevated myself. Your meter is going to measure from where, your meter is going to go on the 5 volt reference line and the battery. And if you have 6 volts, I can guarantee you, you have a bad ground. The ECM's, because the ECM always regulates voltage from where it is. So the ECM goes like this. I'm regulating 5 volts from here to here. So if the ECM grounds are bad, everything elevates. Everything. So if the O2 is going normally from 0.1 to, let's say, 0.9, now it'll go from, let's say it's like 3/10. It'll go from 0.3 to 1.3. That's just the way it is. So if you're reading a sensor and it's higher than normal, anything high, you gotta look for a ground problem. So what's amazing to me is I just went from the battery negative to the engine block. And I had said, crank the car. You always got to crank the car. That's when you stress everything. Look at this. It's amazing. I'm at 3.3 volts. I'm like, dude, that's more than 3/10. You're allowed 3/10 cranking, 1/10 running. That's already loud. Because what you're doing is you're allowing the electrons to flow through the meter. You're going, all right, come on. But you want to come to 0.1. You want to come to 0.2. You, 0.3. Anything above 0.3, they should never go through your meter. It means they can't go the other way. When you create a bridge, they should never go across your bridge. That's like if you're on the parkway, right? And you see the main bridge, the parkway, all backed up. You go, dude, let's go on 109. Let's back out of here, go on 109. Because you see the resistance. Because someone just put up a new bridge, right? The 109 bridge. You're going to go over the 109 bridge. That's what electrons do too. So I said, you know what? You've got a high resistance somewhere. Let's just check battery cables. Let's just check the cables. And the way they did it here, there's two cables here off the battery. One goes over here to the firewall. I'm sorry, to the fender well. And you know where the other one was? On the firewall. Where's that one supposed to go? So we have one on the fender well, the other one on the firewall. Very good. Engine block. So someone worked on the car one time or another and went like this. Where's this thing go? Boom. And who do you think was doing all the work? Look at this guy. Ooh, look at that. Look at the color of that baby. He's going wee, wee, wee. Squeal like a pig, boy. He was taking all the hit. It was amazing that strap was taking all the hit. I'm like, dude, the car's cranking off the strap. Strap went from firewall to the back of the engine. Cooking. So you have to make sure that, just do visuals. I mean, I was amazed like this. Dude, there's no way. Who would do that? It was just amazing to me. This is simple electronics from years ago. I remember I got my, yes?
How about the shipper cable that you should freeze? The shipper cable.
Yes. Oh, well, you're dating me back now, bro. Back in the old days, where you put a shifter cable in on a GM car. I think it was, I forgot what brand it was, but yeah, it was a GM car, but I forgot which one it was. But the shifter cable would melt. And what it would end up being was just bad grounds. They were going through the shifter cable. Bad grounds. You know, one thing that we need to look for is, I've always told you back probe connectors, but connectors are the worst things in the automotive industry because so many things can happen to them. Wires can break right at the connector. They look good. They're held by insulation. You're like this. Bink! And I mean, what happens is a lot of times manufacturers put a lot of tape so they can't break. But I usually take a razor blade. I cut it away and I let them all go and I pull on each one. Because I had a guy last week, he had a GM car with a throttle body problem and he kept getting a throttle body error code. And, you know, the connector looked good. When I opened it up, I found one that was loose. So I just poop. Broke that one, broke the next one, because the tape was holding them all together. So connectors can, the wires can break right at the connector. And this one here was interesting. This is our famous Cadillac CTS. Beautiful car. Look at this thing here. A little gangrene, but I'm going to show you something, see if you can see something here. I'm going to zoom in a little bit. You see something missing over here? Maybe two pins? They rotted. They actually, corrosion got in there, and these two pins, because this guy had an injector, he had a code for an injector. So if he went right to the wire, back probing it, I could ground the injector. But I'm like, the ECM's not grounding it. I don't get what's going on. So when we pull the connector out, I'm like, oh my God, dude, you need an ECM. So now here's my next question. I guess we go get an ECM and we slap that puppy in. Now, I got news for you, because the other day, I had a guy with a corroded transmission computer, and I you can't force stuff. I'm pushing the connector in, it wouldn't go too good. I'm like, why is it going? I didn't force it. I pull down, I see the other two pins, I go, they went this, I'm like, dude, what happened? Well, you all right? Both pins started pushing back into the ECM. I would have ruined that new ECM, and here's why. Look at this. Look at this, just like he said. Look at this. See him right there? Look at him. Look at him. I said, dude, how are you going to get those out of there? And his wife works for them. And she's like, I'll get it out with my little needle. She has a little, I don't know, thread and needle. So I can get that out. I'll work it for a while. I'm like, you're going to have to work that for quite a while. I don't know how you would get that out. I mean, you'd have to replace it. But she claims she can take it out. All right, good. She's like, I don't know. She's got an extractor on her side there with her little patch. Extractor woman. So I said, go, do it. Save a lot of money for your husband there. But just keep smart. When you see things, just be careful. Because I almost ruined that new ECM because I didn't force it all the way. I'm like this. I didn't realize the pins were in there. I thought they disintegrated. I don't know. Another thing, too, is fuse checks. I see this happen all the time. All the time. Where guys go to me. This guy basically had, the reason why I'm bringing this in, because we're going to move forward in these case studies. If I don't cover this, you're going to see a lot of this stuff coming up all the time. All right. Fuses. This guy called me for O2 heater circuit, bank 1 and bank 2, both sides, both heaters. Well, they both O2s had heater problems. Do you think both O2 sensors are bad? Is it a chance? Do you think maybe both drivers independently are bad going to the computer? Do you think maybe the computer's bad and it's saying both O2 heater circuits are bad because I'm at fault? What do you think they have in common? And the guy goes to me, I checked all the fuses. You did? All right, so I look in the manual here, and I can tell you that right there is a fuse for it. So it's 1, 2, 3, fourth fuse down. 1, 2, 3, where is it? But did he check all the fuses? You see? So why would he think that nothing belongs there? Could have been an option. I mean, they leave fuses out all the time. Another thing, too, is if you want to be a detective, right? Wow, I can't zoom in that well, but a lot of these fuses, like the 10, like there's some are upside down. Like it's 7.5 here, and it's 5.7 there, it's upside down, because someone's been in there. But the thing is, don't just get like, I'm going to check all the fuses. There's no guarantee of that either. Find out where the fuse is located. Get your circuit diagram out. Find out what fuse it is. Go after it. Go find it. He just did an easy job. They checked all the fuses in the whole car. They're all good. All right, good. This one was missing. Missing in action. Left out. That's that position in baseball. Left out. Just want to get your mind going. Just to think out of the box a little bit. And the other part is, before we go forward, is once you give the computer what it wants, powers and grounds, right, it needs that, then it feeds stuff out, and they're all called reference. Reference power, reference grounds voltage. They're all references from some type of control device. And understand one thing, that the major guys here, 8-volt reference power, they feed stuff like crank sensor, cam sensor. I can tell you if that line gets shorted, computer goes into hibernation. So if you have a dead computer, won't crank, won't communicate, and you checked all powers and grounds, you better make sure this puppy here is not shorted. Crank sensor's short all the time on Chrysler's. You unplug the crank sensor, computer goes, oh, thank you, God. Somebody was stepping on me, and it hurt, dude. It really hurt. He was holding me down for the count. Computer's going to hibernation. Just by unplugging the crank sensor, check engine light came back on. And then I had, remember that little sign that goes, no bus? Because there's no bus. They ain't running that day. Because the bus is being held down. So I unplugged that, and it up came the mileage. So keep in mind, if you get no communication, powers and grounds are good, before you condemn the computer, make sure you don't have any shareware 8-volt reference feed, power feed, that's taken down. Like stuff. Oh, and then there's shareware, too, for 5-volt reference. TPS, MAP sensor, EGR back pressure sensor. I had one in one shop. It melted. And it's convenient that the ground's there. It took the 5 volts right to the ground like this. This guy was on this car for a while. I'm looking around, I'm like, that thing's melted, dude.
Ford.
There you go. Coolant level sensors also on GM. And air conditioner pressure sensors on Chryslers. So this stuff can happen. So any shareware 5-volt reference or 8-volt reference power will put the computer in hibernation. A 5-volt line just to a dedicated sensor, like a coolant sensor, who cares? Ground me, I'll put the light on and go, coolant sensor shorted. That's dedicated. It'll never happen. And of course, your ground feed's going out. And this new thing, bias voltage, which we're going to talk about. Bias voltage a computer sends out on devices that produce their own voltage. Let's say an AC signal from a wheel speed sensor, right? They always have bias voltage on them, even in airbag systems. You ever see the airbag light? You stop the car, it goes like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Do you think it's going like this to you? Hi, how you doing? I missed you. Glad you're here and you're back. What do you think it's doing for 7 seconds before it goes out? It's doing an integrity check. Airbag systems are the only systems in the entire car that are so critical for checks that they will put bias voltage into every circuit on all the seat belts, the airbag modules, the crank sensors, and they put them in there momentarily or all the time. But other modules may have little drips or drops in it because it's all about this, about money, because you have to build that circuit. So bias voltage is only used to check the integrity of the circuit. You ever notice that you clear the codes for wheel speed sensor and you wait, you start up, wait 10 seconds, shut off, start up, lights on. There's no need to drive the car. There's no need to drive the car because it's a wire, it's a circuit problem. You know it is because the computer already checked the circuit and it's a circuit failure. There's no need to go in there, pull the wheel off, check the tone ring. It's a circuit problem. That's why I always tell guys, when you fix a car, start up, do the three time rule. You shut it off, start it up, wait 10 seconds, shut it off, wait 10 seconds. It's a component test. I do it in every car because I've done airbag jobs, and I'll walk away, and they'll start it up the second time, lights back on. I'm like, damn it, wasn't on the first time. So we went to a second check and failed it. So bias voltage is very important. You're going to see it come up quite a few times. So, I mean, basically, to get back to this car, I went in and checked the powers and grounds. Look. 2 ground feeds, I made it green, because the grass is green, it's on the ground. So I use this test light, because I know how to use this test light. I checked the fuse on both sides, it's dead. Now what? How could it be dead? On both sides. So I'm thinking, you know what? I need to go one step further and find out where it gets its power from. Now this is that panel. It's actually a BCM. It's a fuse panel and a BCM together. And this is what Chrysler uses. All right, they like to do that. They like to take their fuse panel and the BCM and go, how you doing? They live together in harmony. Such harmony. Now look at this. Here's the power feed going in to that panel from the ignition switch. Because if nothing comes out, you have to see if something goes in. Right? So now I know where this wire is located on that panel. So I go back to the panel with my test light. It lights up. So if the roach checks in, they don't check out. What we got here? That whole panel's no good. I got news for you. This panel's on national back order. You can't get them nowhere. And this guy found 3 dealerships who had, they would not give them up. They go, nope, it's for us. They're on national back order. So the only thing I could do for this dude, the only thing we could do, is I had to run a wire temporarily. What are you going to do? And the car started up. I'm like, dude, what do you want to do with that ECM? I can always come back later, but you got to fix this other problem first. It's more crucial. So now, what I did after that, is I brought it back to life. Just to show you, everybody's happy. Now, they're all happy, but these other guys have codes in them. They're all prior codes. I can just hit one button and get rid of everything. But look at this. What's on the PCM right now? What's that little how you doing thing there? Flash file available. So that computer needs to be flashed, if he decides he wants to do that. That the old one anyways. So there's nothing wrong with the old one, but, and this is interesting too. Do you see how this branch is black? And this one's blue. That's a different type of network. How cool is that? They even color the networks different for you to let you know they're like one's a can A, one's a can B. Very intense. One of the best scan tool layouts I've ever seen. They want you to fix cars.
What is that,
WeTech? That's the YTech, yes, YTech. Chrysler has been through a lot of stages. I think they were just a little confused. I mean, they had a DRB, right? That was good for a while. Then they went to the Star scan. They said, well, let's use this. And then they went to the next one. They went to the Star Mobile. This is good. Then they went to the Y-Tech. Why? I don't know. Y-Tech? Why? That's what they're using now. And this all happened within a couple of years. They didn't know what they wanted to do. So that's why don't be too quick to buy the newest thing. It happens. Next car was a Pontiac Bonneville. And the guy goes to me, my power window switch works. The window on the left side. No problem. Up and down. The other three don't work. Do you think he's got three bad window motors? Eh. Do you think he's got maybe a common ground feed that's bad on those other three? Could be. Do you think he's got maybe a common power feed on those three? Could be. I mean, these are things that go into my mind that I need to check. But without a diagram, you're not going to find this. So I have to get my diagram. But prior to that, this is not your friendly window switch of yesteryear. It's not a window switch no more. It's a module. It's a how you doing module that if you buy a new one, it's going to be programmed. It don't work till you program it. Amazing. That little sucker here is now called a DDM, driver door module. And the thing is, I hooked up my scan tool to talk to the driver door module. I said, could you clue me in? Let me know what's going on. Help me out. Throw me a bone. I lost communication with the passenger door module. Oh, did you now? I lost communication with the left rear door module. Oh, did you now? And I lost communication with the right rear door module. Now, I'm thinking, what is this thing all about? And why doesn't my scanner talk to the other modules? Why is it not in the menu? It's a GM scan tool. I can only talk to the one and not the other three. So now this gets interesting because I want to go find out how it works. And look at this thing I drew. This is pretty cool stuff. Look. Look at this. I made orange feed. No, first of all, see this circuit breaker? It's heavy-duty feed. The circuit breaker is going to be used for what? Not to wake the module up. To supply high power current for the window motors. So look. They all share the same feed for the window motor. All of them. And they're all spliced in up here at the fuse panel. So I'm like, well, can't be that. Or else that guy. I'm just using logics here. I mean, you fight all your wars right here. You put the paper here, because I see guys go too quick. I'm like, dude, chill out, bro. All great generals won wars here at the war table. The war room is right here. Fight the war here. Don't go out there with a gun and just, so, well, let me get the guy behind the bushes. Where is he? You get killed. Just put a game plan together. I just sit there, it's like thinking, like playing a game. Like, well, it can't be this one because this guy's working. And look at the grounds. This guy here has a different ground. This guy here has a different ground. This guy here, they all have, so it can't be a ground. They all have different grounds. Now look at this. Ignition feed. He has his own ignition feed. This guy here has his own ignition feed. These two guys share the same ignition. So I'm thinking, well, if these three guys are out, I doubt it has two blown fuses. It could be, but one thing I saw was this. You see these blue lines here? Boom, boom, boom. They all share their own little private network that no scan tool could get into. They call it UART, U-A-R-T. It's a private little network between computers that scan tools cannot get into. Because they don't want you to know. They have their own little, hey, how you doing? You can't talk to us. You're not in our club. It's our own little private club. So I'm like, you know what? That's where I want to go. And then I read this. I get excited. I read this. Look at this one. Well, it just says it's located under the driver's seat. Well, you know what? What could be under the driver's seat? Under the carpet? I'm thinking maybe water. So I say, you know what, dude? Let's lift the seat up. I'm on a hot run here. I have a feel. I got this feel. Every now and then you get a little feel. He lifts up the rug. And look at this. Look at that. What's that back there? Rust? Where is rust? There must have been water. That's my notion. Moisture. Something. And the wire actually runs. Look, it runs over the hump. Because I'm imagining this in my mind. Where would I split this wire? If the wire from the ALDL connector was right over here, has to run over the hump right here. Then it has to go up this B pillar. The A pillar would be up front here. Then it has to go out this way. And I'm picturing this in my mind. I'm using like high-tech x-ray vision like this. All right, where could a sucker be? Because you have to. You don't want to serve up the whole car part. I want to hone in as close as I can. I'm thinking then it goes this way and it goes that way. I says, you know what, dude? It's got to be in this area. Let's just start ripping this apart. So we go in. We open it up. And I'm like, dude, what's that? It's taped. It's all taped up. Looks like someone put a splice and laid it in a harness, under in a conduit, under a carpet. Who does that? GM. So now I take it off. And now I'm getting excited. I never got so excited. I started hugging the dude. I'm like, dude, give me, I want a tech hug. I hugged him. And look at this. Look at the corrosion. They actually spliced all four wires right there. Well, what's on their mind? So we literally had to take that all apart. And we had and I just told him to solder it. I mean, we twist tied it just for now. And all the windows started working again. And here's what's amazing to me. Think about this one. Each window motor has their own power and ground feed, has their own switch. Why would they not all three work independently of the boss? Who's in charge? Boss. Do you know, as long as those guys can't talk to the boss, they don't go to work. They're like sitting like this. Hey, Fred, what are you doing? Oh, I'm not doing nothing. Am I supposed to work on that car? No, not till the boss tells us to. So they're all hanging out. What kind of network is that? It's not a private network that we each guy can do independently what he wants. The boss is in charge. So I learned a lot from that car. So we fixed that. And after we fixed that, everything's working. I'm like, dude, there's two more codes left. Left mirror horizontal position sensor. Left mirror vertical position sensor. What's that all about? So then I get a diagram. I'm like, dude, from the computer in the door, there's a sensor in the mirror. I think something's up with that mirror or the wire's broken. He goes, oh, I forgot to tell you, this mirror got whacked. It fell off the car, so I just put it back in place. So I think what happened was that it somehow got damaged when it got whacked. But I didn't care at that point. I mean, his windows are working. That's the bottom line. But what's really incredible here is that it's not just about power and ground no more. It's communication lines now are taking their place into the arena. So you can't rule those guys out. Communication lines are very critical. You need to check them from end to end. I mean, I would have got a little, if I wanted to get anal, I could have took a voltage reading at the window switch, that took a voltage reading at each one of the switches to see if the same pattern was on a line. Because all you're going to see is, you're just going to see up and down motion. It can go from 0 to 1 or 0 to 3. I don't know. Because there's no real book on it. There's a guy, Doc something, who came out here, dude. He does nothing but networks. He's a network genius. But he spends a lot of time reading all these things. You know, taking pictures and waveform patterns, but that's very anal. But it's good, though, because he can present that to you. Tire pressure monitor systems, as of 2008 and up, standard on all cars now. So there's no way of getting away around it. There's no way of getting away on it. And here's the thing. There's a lot of tools out there. Everyone says, well, I got this, I got the one that I use, and they've been around for quite a while, is Bartek. But, you know, I bought the one Bartek 300, and I paid, like, I don't know, two bills for that. Then they went to Bartek 300, and I bought that one for, like I don't know, I think it was, like, $400. And, I mean, it's nice, but now they got the Big McGill for $2,500. It's got a screen on it. Because now a lot of these manufacturers, it's no longer where you could just turn the key on, and then you go, bump, bump, bump on the brake pedal. Turn the key off, and you go boom, 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 turn the key on. Then you hear the horn go beep, beep, beep. Then you take a magnet, you go by each wheel, boop, boop, boop. It's not that way no more. Because certain manufacturers, you have to extract the numbers out of all the wheels because you don't want to break them down. That's too much work. You're going to break down a tire and read the ID and go, oh, look at the ID. That's a lot of work. So the tool will extract it and show it on the screen. Then once it extracts them all, then you walk over the car, you plug it into the car, and you send it off to the processor, where I have to have two tools. I use this extractor, right? And I extract all the numbers and the IDs from all the tires. Then I hook it into my computer through a USB, then it comes up on the screen. I'm like, oh, there it is. I print it out, then I walk over to the car on my laptop and I have to put in all the numbers. It's a lot of work. That $2,600 is looking real good. Real good. I may have to get it. I may have to just get it. What am I going to do? But all these cars now, you have to do a procedure of marrying the sensors to the car. So he calls me up and says, the light is on. Right? There's that little famous light. Now, by the way, if the light is on with certain manufacturers, it means you're low on pressure. If the light's flashing in your face, ain't a pressure problem. There could be something wrong with the sensor. Could be that it's dead, has a problem. There's a code in the system, an error code. That's not going to go away by just driving. You could drive the car around to Earth's creation. If there's a problem with it, it's not going to work. And Honda goes one step further. I called you on that one.
Yeah.
So I called up my buddy here. He's the Acura specialist. And I said, dude, I don't understand. It's got a tire pressure monitor light, and it's got a TPMS light. And the tire pressure monitor light is not on, but the TPMS light's on. What's up with that? He goes, well, if you have a failure problem, then the TPMS light comes on. If you have low pressure, then the low pressure light, that light goes on. So they don't do the flashing like, hey, how you doing to get your attention? They just put a different light on. It's another acronym we have to deal with, TPMS. So it turned out that the guy had a bad receiver on the fender well, because they do a little different. They have a little receiver here, and the wheel transmits to the receiver, and then each receiver's in each wheel well, and then they're all wired to a module. I'm like, why? What kind of technology is that? Just get a big Magilla box going, okay, who's out there? Wireless, I'm wireless. Why? I don't understand it. I can't comprehend it. So you're wireless from here to here. Does that make any sense? So when the car got whacked, it did some damage to that little sensor. But that's what Honda uses. That's their idea. I don't get it. Everyone has their own. Everyone wants to be different. They all want to be different. So now I'm going to go to this car and relearn all the tires. All right? Because he said that he had a tire replaced, and maybe it was away from the shop for too long, and the car, you know, the guy worked on the car, maybe had the tire away. I don't know what happened, but the bottom line is I had to retrain all the tires. So I go to the first tire, and it beeped my tool. I thought it was a different beep. I just can't remember, but I was waiting for my tool, my laptop, to recognize it because it should turn green, okay? So I'm there at that tire. And it's not my tool's not responding. I go to the next side. Beep, I get the green light. Put it in the wrong position because it never started the sequence. Then I went the left rear, the right rear. Beep. I went to the left, left rear. Beep. I went back to that left front tire again. It won't initiate the process. I'm like, I think there's something wrong with that wheel. So I go in with the tool, and as I'm working on the car, I'm like, I'm working on left front wheel. Is there something wrong with this picture? I'm over here working on a wheel. What do we see there?
Another wheel.
Another wheel. They had a Mercedes wheel right there. And I'm thinking, well, I'm just using the guy in the box again. I'm like, maybe because that one's there, it's getting confused. So let's roll that sucker out of the way. Because they always tell you, make sure when you do this job that no other tires are around the area, because it'll pick that one up. So then the light goes out. You drive the car out. You leave the buddy behind that you learned by accident, and then the light comes back on again. How cool is that? But just when you do this job, make sure no other tires are around. So now, I moved it out of the way and did it again, still wouldn't take. So I take my tool, and I extracted the information out of it, and tell me what you see. What do we see here? Are they all Manchesters? Are they Schrader 4096? Who said that? Wrong what? How can it be wrong Hertz? The car had no problems when it left the shop. He just sent it out to a tire shop.
They probably broke one and put it back in.
Hey, Fred, is there something you want to tell me? Because you know the old story, it always comes out in the wash. Is there something? Well, let me tell you what happened. My tech accidentally broke it, but we had another one just like it in the shop. So we have a little box of them, and we kind of like slipped it in. Well, you slipped in the wrong one, Fred. You screwed me, Fred. So that's what happened. They all look alike.
I've done it, that's why.
Yeah. Dude, it happens, right?
It happens.
We're all human. And you would never think it. It looks the same, right? When I say if it looks like a duck, walks like a duck, it quacks like a duck, it may not be a duck. Just be careful. You never know. So I just want you to be aware of that, that whenever you plug in parts, they may not all be the same. They may not. So just be aware of when you get in that kind of mode. Heisel is a pretty good case study because that one had me going. Because, you know, somebody was holding information back. Here's something to think about. You know, when I saw this code, I'm like, oh my God, I got to present this. This guy is a food for thought. A 2010 Mazda 3, airbag light on. And look at this. Connector, half insertion detected. That sounds like a personal problem with this computer. I'm thinking, how does it know about half insertion? Is there like a half insertion sensor in this car that I don't know about? But I just thought it was pretty unique. And I'm like, all right, let's just go forward with this. Let's look. Maybe it knows. So I go wander. I says, let's pull up the console and see what's going on. I look at this airbag module. I'm going in deep. Right? And look at this. Would you say that's half insertion, about three-quarter insertion? It wasn't fully seated. Wasn't fully seated. And I was like, you know what? It's not even in the wiring diagram. How does it know? And by the way, this statement 22, I use it all the time on connections. You want to write this stuff here? You could buy this from Standard Ignition. It's called SL5. I use it on all connections, mostly airbag connections because they're critical to ohms. You can have a half ohm drop on any connection dealing with an airbag, a seatbelt, not crash sensors, and they will set a code. They won't tolerate anything over half an ohm. I mean, look at the airbag clock spring. It is a half ohm. So they don't want deviation. And you can unplug it, plug it back in. The problem may go away, but it's going to come back. So this stuff here is like the magic juice. I use it on all computer terminal connections. When electricity flows through, it becomes conductive. Pretty wicked stuff. And I used to get it for $50 a bottle. I went back to get it. It took me 2 years to use it all up. You have to use it a little bit at a time. Guy's like, oh, it's 70 bucks. It's 70 bucks. Dude, are you out of your mind? I'm going to go start checking Costco, see if I can get it a little cheaper. $70 you hit me for. Times are tough. So they hit me for that. But look at this. I want you to see this connector.
Can I make a comment?
Yes.
Everybody, that SL5 enhances the conductivity through the terminal, but it actually acts like a dielectric. It isolates one terminal from the other as well.
Okay. Very good point. So don't worry about if you just spill it all over. It'll dedicate that pin to have great connection. And it won't come back. It will not come back. It's amazing, amazing stuff. And if you look in here, these are regular pins for the airbag module. See these two pins right there? The two pins. And what they're going to do when you put the connector in, there's a shorting bar. So they have two wires. Here's all the regular wires are, but there's two wires on the connector. Right? And what do you think is in those two wires that the computer uses to determine if we have a connection? Because it's going to go plug into those two terminals. What do you think it's using? Bias voltage? It uses bias voltage, or reference voltage, and a ground. So that when these two connect, okay, it's going to see circuit low. Computers only understand high and low, by the way. Nothing in between when it goes for seeing certain, well, unless it's a potentiometer, but it understands highs and lows. So if it sees 5 volts, it knows it's open. If it sees 0 volts, it knows it's shorted. So when you don't put it all the way in, inside a connector, there's a shorting bar. It's a metal bar. And when you push that in, all right, there's the plastic piece. There's a little plastic piece right there. That plastic piece pushes the shorting bar away, and those two pins mate. Those two wires mate with these two pins. So then it goes back to 5 volts. So pull it back a little bit, that shorting bar comes down, and pulls it the 5 volts down the ground, and a computer knows that connector's not all the way in. I just think it's a pretty cool thing that they do with airbags in itself to check connector integrity. A lot of times I find connectors are not usually fully seated. They're not. I see it all the time where guys, I'm like, dude, you have to go in there, get the feel and the snap. Snap! Maybe you had the radio on too loud. I go to shops, the radio is so loud. I'm like, dude, turn the noise down. Can't hear yourself work. Right? Or some guys, they'll put like headphones with the tunes. Yeah. What happened to the good old days where you just like snap, crackle, pop? I like to hear those noises. That's all part of your job. Something to think about. Food for thought. And here's a 2001 Chevy Corvette, no start, no crank nightmare. Now understand one thing, that a lot of computers now control the cranking of the car. They control the starter relay. And a lot of them have security systems. So no start, no crank could be a security system problem, could be an ECM that's dead. We don't know. But here's the thing. I'm going to go with my scan tool. Remember I said, take your scan tool and go into every single computer you can, all of them. Dot the I's and cross the T's. And on this car, you would have no communication for every single module. Everyone you went into, whether it had been airbag, ABS, engine, whatever you went into, there would be no communication. So do you think all those computers are bad? Do you think every one of them share the same ground? Every one of them share the same power? I don't think so. This is a network problem. Something that's very, very common and happening more and more to me. It's killing me. Because there's certain cars I can't do because the complexity of trying to pull all these computers off the network to find out who's shorting it out. But GM, on the other hand, I have to give them credit, they find a place to put all these wires together, network wires, and bridge them together in one spot. On a Cadillac I did a few weeks ago, they soldered 5 together here and 4 together over here. That's what they did. And they ran the ALDL connector to both of them. So it depends on the system. What's nice about the Tech 2 is I have something here called Class 2 DTC check. What it's going to do is it's going to go in and check the whole network. And by the way, I'm not here to knock aftermarket tools, but I'm here to tell you there's not one aftermarket tool that I know of that does network checking. And they can't. Reason being is you have to be able to support every single module on that car. And they don't. I mean, AutoLogic comes very, very close. I mean, I have the AutoLogic. They come very, very close, but I don't see a button on there that says network. They go in and check all the modules, but there's no button that does network checking on the certain vehicles that they do support. And it's important because, I mean, look at that Chrysler where I was able to check the whole network. With a GM tool, I go there, I hit it, and it's going, I can't communicate with nobody. Everyone on the network is gone or dead. So here's what I had to resort to. I looked up at a diagram, and I found out where all these guys come together. Now, here's what they use. They call this the star connector. All it is they took, here's the purple wire from the ALDL connector, another purple wire over here. They put them all in here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. On this side, there's probably 4 or 5 on this side. You see. So, if you wanted to, you could do it without this special tool I bought. You literally take these combs out. They're actually combs. You pull them out. And you can get a piercer, pierce this wire, and just get your little wiring diagram and find out what each one of these are for. See how they're color-coded? Some manufacturers don't do that. Not on this Cadillac I worked on. They were all purple. So I'm like, where do you go? Where are you from? So how do you know? So now what you would have to do is you'd have to literally go like this. Put one on and go to each computer, see which one showed up. Back out. All right, write him down. Label him. Go next one. Bring him on and see if he came up. One at a time. That's like eight times to go in and out. With my tool, I can just leave the screen on, and as I bring one guy on, he comes up on the screen. I bring another guy on, a second guy adds on the screen. Bring another guy on, a third guy adds to the list. That's the way I did it. Now, each one of these guys are color-coded, so all I do is go to a regular diagram, and I can see where they're all coming from. But see, I cheated a little bit. I'm going to show you what I did. I bought this tool a long time ago because I didn't know what it was all about. But the guy says, can you program a Corvette? I'm like, yeah, sure, no problem. So I get there, I'm programming. It says, You need tool number J42236-A. I'm like, what the heck is that? And I call up the dealer. You got one? You got J42236-A? Yeah. How much is that? $600. $600. So I'm like, dude, I got to spend $600 to do this job. Well, I said, well, you know what? Maybe I'll get another Corvette eventually. I don't know. So what this tool does, it's got a dial. You can dial in any one of these pins to one wire. So what they made you do is they made you dial in to PCM. If you look at the way this thing is set up, you see how the knob goes in letters? It has A, B, C, D, or up to M. And each one, like B is for PCM, D is for radio, E is for ABS, F is for airbag, G is for IPC, interpanel, so forth and so on. So you're isolating each pin. And all you have to do is go to the PCM and then you program the computer. I'm like, Jesus, all I had to do is just get one wire. I pull the combs out. I could have found a PCM wire, joined to the purple, and I was done. I could have saved $600, but I didn't know. I didn't take the time out to see what this tool did. But that's what it does. But then, you know what? Now I use it as a diagnostic tool. So what I did was this. I got my little handy-dandy wiring diagram, all right? I just started playing elimination game. So what I did was I went in, and one at a time like this, one at a time on the screen, I hooked one up, had a communication, and I checked off all the guys that would communicate. This is the way it's done. I'm here to tell you, this is the way it's done. It's time consuming. I had probably 2 hours in this car. It's a lot of work. So I went into it, right? Up there, I put a star by the automatic air conditioning control, sorry, the electronic climatic control, because I had no communication because the car didn't have it. It's just a standard air conditioning with, you know, levers and switches. So it didn't have it. And then there was this other thing called the remote control door lock receiver, which also didn't communicate. And then there was this electronic suspension computer, which didn't communicate. And then there was this other guy who was not even there. That brown and white wire was missing. So that must have been like an option. I don't know, but it was not there at all. So now I had two guys to contend with. So out of all those guys, I narrowed down to two guys. So it was eeny, meeny, miny, mo. That's what I did. So I said, let me go after the air suspension, the suspension. I cut it. I checked the network, and it's still no communication. Then I cut this other one, and they all came up. See how they all come up? I'm going to show you how they all come up with my scan tool. See how it labels them all? And the way it would be is these guys would all be missing. If I bought the PCM by itself, I'd have that guy by itself, then that guy by itself, then that guy by itself. But then I hooked them all back up and cut that wire. Now they're all up and running. So I'm like, all right, what is this thing all about? It's something to do with remote door locks. So I went in the back corner panel, and I'm like, it's three wires. So I unplugged it. I hooked the other wire back up that I cut, and it's still working. I'm like, that thing's no good. You think that thing's no good? I unplug it, and everybody's up and running. So I go get a new one, plug it in. Or should I check those wires? There's power here. There's the wire going back to that connector and ground. Now, I want you to know one thing. That if the module's bad, it could backfeed power or ground into the data line. If the module loses ground, it can backfeed power because it's looking for a ground. So you better realize how that works. That a module is either bad or losing power or ground. It can do weird stuff to the data line. Do you know on an Audi, if the fuse blows on the back of the radio, you got to take the whole radio out. The whole radio's got to come out. If the fuse blows on the back of the radio, the network is all down because it backfeeds through the circuit. So you got to take the radio out, put the fuse in, put it back in. Now you have communication with the whole car. Crazy. That's the way they do it. It's out there. So I went. I checked over here. I checked on my logic probe, and it lit up red. Now, you know when you check a light bulb and the ground's busted? What do you have on both sides of the bulb? Power, right? You have power on one side, and you have power on the other side because there's no ground. It's back face. I'm like, I'll give it a ground. So I took my little Panoma piercer, put it on there, pierced it. Let me give it a ground. I go down, I'm like, oh my God. I took the lead off. It fried my Panoma. My Panoma fried. And it melted it, and the needle would not move no more. It's done. That's $20 down the drain. Gone. I'm like, that sucks. As they ain't looking for a ground. That must be power. How is that power? So I unplugged it. Still power on there. It's hot. I mean, you know, you put a logic probe on it. You don't know if that's 12 volts feed, you know, a feedback, or is that 12 volts hot? It was 12 volts hot. I'm like, how does the ground get hot? How? Is it touching power somewhere? It's got to be. But that's a straight run. So now I had to get a diagram. And I find out that it feeds. Oops, hold on. Let me go back. Bad Johnny. Okay. I found out that it feeds right by the battery. That's where it feeds, right by the battery on the frame. That's a big, hefty wire. I got power there. I have ground here, and I have power back there. I'm like, now I have to find out where that wire runs. So I follow this wire in, and it goes through the kick panel on the right-hand side, through this Magilla box, a junction box where everybody's happy. They ran it through this box, out of the box, back to the car. I'm like, why would you want a ground through a junction box? Why not just bring it through the firewall like the good old days and just run along the rail? It'd be much easier. So I take a closer look at this thing. Now, there's the ground. I check it. It's hot. Who do you think's next to it? Battery. Why would you put a battery feed and a ground feed next to each other? And the battery feed's going, how you doing? The ground's going, how you doing? He goes, you want to be hot? No. Well, you're hot now. You're so hot. Boom, done. And do you know what that wire did? Do you think it went back this way, or do you think it went back to the big Magilla? The big Magilla said, dude, go ahead, hit me. Because there's a splice right there. You're not taking me down. Splice is going down before me. It ran through that whole unit, all into the splice, and stopped and burned at the splice. So I call Richie Shorts. I'm like, Richie, this one's for you, bro. It's up your alley. Some labor involved here, bro. I mean, I know how to fix it. I could bridge it. But here's the thing. When you have a wire burning through a whole harness, you got some serious work there. You got some serious repair. This guy didn't want to get involved in it. He said, I don't want to fix that. That's a lot of work. I'm like, well, then you have to hire someone to fix it. So Richie likes these electrical nightmares. He went in there, ripped it all apart, and actually this panel had to be replaced because it was fried. You could not get this connector. I couldn't get the connector off. It would not come off. So can you imagine that a data line could be shorted to positive and still all the computers survive? And I'm thinking here that the computers have to have a protection internally, that if it gets hit with high voltage, it must clip it. But what happens is the whole network is taken down. So a network can be taken down by corrosion, bad connections. It can be taken down by being grounded or fed to power. One of three different ways. And there's two good cases right there, yes. All right, so that was interesting. Here's another scenario. 2000 Ford Explorer, ABS light on ever since the accident. And you know, you don't know. When you even get any car in the shop, and let's say you're working on it, people claim that, well, this worked before, and then now you're married to it. So what do you got to do now? You got to check all these cars when they come in, take pictures of lights. I know a lot of shops that actually take pictures. They take a digital image of all lights. Clink, before they start. It's got the date, time, and there it is. Man, that light was on. No, it wasn't. Look at this. How you doing? I'm not married to it. You are. So what do you want to do about it? Sometimes there's lights that are on, and you want to know before you work on the car. Because people can play games. They can play games with you. You got to watch out with that. And here's something too. When you ID your tool, there's a lot of questions a scan tool is going to ask you. You better have an answer. If it asks you what color the car is, black. Does it have four-wall or two-wall ABS? Does it have a traction control? Does not have traction control. Does it have four-wheel drive? Or does not have four-wheel drive. You have to answer all these questions because what you do is you're configuring your tool to talk to that car. Right? So, I mean, you look at this question here. It says, is this vehicle equipped with advanced track roll stability control or IVD? IVD. Tech is IVD. No, that kind of, I know what IUD is. That's the stuff they used back in the 70s, right? But IVD, I don't know what it is. So I had to do a little, well, the first time I answered no. I'm going to show you something. Interactive vehicle dynamics. What they'll do on the Ford is they'll have a vacuum switch inside the booster. If it has that, it's IVD. Because what happened to me was I put in there, I said, no. I didn't know. And what happened was, now the tool, instead of talking through CAN network, it talked through an ISO network. So it was on a different pin, looking for a different protocol, and it came up as no communication. I'm like, wow, the ABS module doesn't talk. The ABS light's on. Let me go check powers and grounds. I check the data lines. It's got to be a bad ABS module. Put it in, went back, same problem. Like, uh-oh, like this. Dude, I'm married now, dude. I don't know what to do here. So I'm like, you know what, remember that one question I had? I'm saying to myself, let me answer yes. So I answered yes, it went in. And it was something stupid. But can you imagine, by IDing my scan tool with the wrong information, I had no communication. That was pretty sad. That was stupid on my part. And ever since that day, I've been always looking to get an answer for the question to that scan tool. I had no idea. I never had an idea. And look at this. I'm going to show you something. Do you know that if you answer yes, look what shows up on the screen. All right? Look at the menu that shows up on the screen. Interactive vehicle dynamics. All right? If you answer no, it doesn't show up. It's not there. It's not even, you can't even select it. And the protocols are different for different systems. So just make sure that you answer the right question. You'll get yourself in trouble. I'm here to tell you. It happened to me. So we get a code here. 1235, right rear wheel speed sensor input signal missing. Then we get 1236, which is the opposite side. So it's saying both wheel sensors didn't say circuit. There was never a word that said circuit. It says the signals are missing. It doesn't see them. It's all right. Do you think we have two bad wheel sensors? Could be. Do you think we have two bad tone rings? Could be. Because it'd be on one car that I misdiagnosed. I'll never forget as long as I live. Jaguar. They replaced both wheel sensors. Still no real speed. I checked integrity wires. I'm like, Jesus, must be something wrong with that ECM. Let's get a used one, just to cover me here. Didn't work. So I'm like, oh my God. What else does B? We took out the sensors. Do you know both trigger wheels were rotted? Dude, they were rotted. Nothing left of them. I'm like, oh, I didn't know this could happen. I never knew this could happen. Both sides are rotted. What's the chance of that? Well, guess what? That was a bad day for me. So what are you going to do? But it happens. So I left that out because in my mind I'm like, there's no way I have two bad tone rings. But it can happen. So that's what I'm thinking, maybe two bad tone rings. I said, you know what? I'm going to go back there and make sure the sensors are fully seated. They're in place. Because if the sensor is not fully seated, it's too far away. Right? So maybe it's not going to pick up anything. So I said, let me go back to do an integrity check because I know it's not electrical. It's something mechanical. So I go back there. Oh, first of all, I took it for a ride to validate this. I took it for a ride. As you can see, there's nothing from the left rear or the right rear. Nothing whatsoever. They're dead in the water. Right? Okay, see, they're dead in the water. They're not working at all. I'm like, all right, both rear wheel sensors are definitely not working. So let me go back there and see what's going on. So I go back there. Lo and behold, no matter where I look, I can't find a sensor on either side. I'm like, they're missing.
There's only one sensor on the rear of that thing, right?
Well, no one told me that. But look at this. Can I go back on this one? Watch this. Watch. Look at this. I went back to our famous tool. Now, I saw up there service manual or tech service bulletin. They wrote a bulletin on this problem. Because I wasn't the only one that was confused on this. Their technicians were too. And it says here, Some vehicles may exhibit an anti-lock brake system warning lamp illuminated with diagnostic trouble codes C1235, C1236, and or C1237. Wheel speed right rear input signal missing. Wheel speed left rear input signal missing. Rear wheel speed sensor output failure, stored memory. This may be due to an internal intermittently functioning differential mounted rear wheel speed sensor. We're sorry. We didn't mean to put that in the data stream. We didn't mean to write two separate codes for the car and confuse you. But here's what the problem is. We only have one sensor in the car. I never saw that done ever on any manufacturer. So now I'm digging for this thing, and it's on top of the differential. Buried on top. Way up there. Way up there. And I was amazed that they have one sensor, and it's going to give data to both wheels, and the computer thinks there's four wheels moving for three sensors. So it's something that threw me a curveball. I wasn't understanding it, but I saw, I'm like, well, maybe, according to that, it's causing two codes. So that was the problem with that. And here's something else I did, just to show you something. I just unplugged the sensor. Now, I know it's a wheel speed sensor. It produces its own AC voltage. What's that 11.8 volts when I plug into that sensor?
Bias
voltage. I want to just validate the wires are good from there to the computer and just to see what kind of reading it is. Now, here's the next one. Car gets into an accident. Breaks the crash sensor. And screws up the wiring. Right? So the guy puts it all back together. Fix the wire, gets a new crash sensor, and he ends up with crash sensor fault. Oh, you know, so you go there, you check the wires from the sensor all the way back to the computer. They're good. Brand new sensor. Should we put a computer in there? It keeps sending a fault. What is it? What? What? Say out loud. Do you know that a lot of computers, when they send out bias voltage, not necessarily reference voltage, they want to put voltage through the circuit in one direction. It may not go through that circuit the other direction, so it can't see it. So some of these devices are biased to one direction. Wheel speed sensors that are resistive type, not a problem. You get magnetic resistive types, the ones that make square waves. You can't ohm them out. They're a different technology. If you reverse the wires on those, you'll also get a wheel speed sensor code. So, and I can't blame this guy because when the wire broke, he had an orange and a white. The brand new sensor came red and white. So what would you do? White to white, red to orange, right? They're like the same family. If you piss on this one, it turns orange, right? Red and yellow is orange. So they're kind of like the same family. So he did the right thing, but can you imagine it has to go white to red and then orange to white? Crazy, crazy. So all it was a reverse polarity. So you have to watch out for that because, like I said, on a lot of these wheel speed sensors today, they're doing away with AC voltage. They're using DC voltage. And it's not a square wave that goes from 0 to 5 volts like we're used to, 0 to 5, 0 to 5. They elevate it. So they make it 1.5 to 2.5. It's a small square wave. Now, why do you think they went from sine wave to square wave? Look, I'm sorry. Can a sine wave, tuck a tuck a tuck a tuck a tuck, can a sine wave see this? Amplitude's too low. And they use square wave because square waves can detect creep. They can see wheel speed at 1 mile an hour. You ever see it in certain scan tools? They don't start wheel speed till 3 miles an hour. You stop and you got three. Then you move again, you have 4, 5, 6, you stop, you have 3. Well, I'm the 1, 2. Because that's when you have your problems, when you slow down, 1 mile an hour. So the thing is they were going down the square, and you can't ohm these like you would the other ones. The other resistive ones, 500, 1200 ohms. These other ones have a trick, and it works every time. I put my ohm meter on the highest reading, like 100 million ohms, and I measure the sensor, because you're putting a battery through the sensor. That's what the ohmmeter is. You're measuring resistance. You put it through, it'll be 1.2 million ohms. You put the lead the other way, 5.8 million ohms. It's not in no book. I just go to each sensor. 1.2, 5.7, 1.2. But wait, I went last week. The fronts and the rears are a little different because of the distance. So it'll be 1.2, 5.7, 1.2, 5.7. Then you do the rear one, it's like 2.4 and 8.7. They're a little different because of distance. But I know that two have to be the same. The other two have to be the same. And I'm getting a different reading either way. And it works. It validates the sensor. It really does. Because they don't want you measuring it. Other than that, you have to put a scope on it and drive it. It's just a quick way of doing it.
So what would a bad sensor read?
Well, like I had one that it reads totally different than the other one. Like maybe it'll read like 0.5 instead of 1.5. And like, or you'll have more reading a higher voltage and this one is reading a low voltage. And at the same time, you have a code for him. At the same time, he doesn't register the scanner. So now I'm like, you know what? And then I'll go at the other end. And here's another thing I'll do. I'll go to the sensor end to validate the harness. I check for bias volt. I check for voltage. Because the computer sends reference power to that sensor. That type of sensor needs power. It'll send like 11.8 volts and a ground. A constant. So you just measure it, and they're all going to be the same feed. So you measure it. So now you ruled out the computer, and you ruled out the harness. Because you could have a bad driver inside that ECM. ABS systems, ABS-5, Bosch, a lot of problems. It's common. You get a code for two rear sensors, and then you get a unit rebuilt, and does the same thing. So now you're like in denial, and you get another one rebuilt, does the same thing. So then you tell the guy, let's get a brand new one. Get a brand new one, it's fixed. Why is that? Is that rebuilder really rebuilding it? And I have to go there 3-4 times for the same exact identical problem because a rebuilder can't rebuild it right? Or what's he doing? Just going like this? Let me sandblast this puppy. Let me paint it up, slap it, let him test it for me. Because that's what happens, I believe. That there's no reason why that monitor should have 3 failures in a row. It's upsetting because it kind of sidetracks us. But you know what I say? Go back to where you started. Test and retest. Test and retest. Other than that, you'll be all over the map. Because it happens. And I don't want to get burned by rebuilders. We know about rebuilders. Okay? And just for the heck of it, when I unplugged those sensors, I got a different code. Right rear real speed sensor input circuit failure. Now I got the other code, circuit failure. I want to see if it changed from hooked up to unhooked. I want to see if the computer would change its strategy about the information it was giving me. So the word, since it mentioned the word circuit, I knew it was a circuit problem. Before, it didn't mention the word circuit. But it's nice to know what codes can be generated by that car. I mean, if you can get a code list, you'll learn what that problem could be. Is it a circuit problem or is it a mechanical problem? Should I drive it or should I not drive it? And here's our Jeep Grand Cherokee. This one kicked my butt. Runs erratic and cuts out at times. This guy called me up in his Jeep and said, John, I got this Jeep. It's driving me crazy. He goes, there's no codes. And you'll drive it and it just starts bucking. Just jerking. Bucking. Buck, 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 buck. I said, all right, well, I'll take a look at it. Now, he couldn't get there at 7 o'clock in the morning. So I got there at 7 o'clock in the morning, hooked up. And I felt it. And I'm like, God, this thing's cutting in and out. He says, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to check the 5-volt reference, which is the heartbeat. If the heartbeat drops out, I know the computer. I mean, it's a quick thing to do. Monitor the heartbeat. Because if the heart stops, the computer stopped. So I monitor the 5 volts on just one part of my scope. Then I monitor crank and cam signal. I want to see who's leaving town. Because it was so abrupt. And the tachometer would like dip too at the same time. So I'm checking it. And would you believe after 15 minutes, the problem went away? So I'm like this, oh, Jesus. So I started playing around. I couldn't get that to happen again. So I left the shop because I had my hour rule. So I called him like, dude, I don't know. To me, I never lost the crank sensor, never lost the cam sensor, never lost 5 volts. It feels like this computer has got a problem. It's jerky. There's got to be something wrong with it. So I said, I'm going to have to reschedule to come back there and go all through it. I just don't know. He goes, what do you think? You think it could be an ECM? I says, I don't know. I mean, what happened? He goes, well, the guy had high-performance coils put in. He put them in, and ever since then, the car hasn't been running right. So I took them out, and I put the old ones back in. It's still the same problem. I'm like, well, I don't know, dude. I said, maybe those coils damaged the computer. I'm thinking, I'll tell you what. You go get a computer, I'll come there, and I'll program it for you, and I'm not even charging my time. I mean, because the car just doesn't act up all the time. Put it in, Oh, my God. Oh. Now, I was married to that car. Because you want to know something, dude? That car was there for a while. Now it's mine, my baby. I said, you know what, dude? I'm going to come there after hours, and I'm not leaving. I'm going to stay there until we figure this thing out. Because now we're both married. You want the ring? See, you wear it too now, dude. We're married to this car. We're the bitches. We're married. There's no turning back. So then I went back there, and I said, I have to get a whole new strategy here. So I went in, I checked for codes, no codes. And I'm scanning this thing, and here's what the car's doing. Well, I got it to act up. It's going, so it's doing. I mean, and at times it was just cut out. I'm like, Jesus, what's up with this car? I don't get it. This is RPM. This is map. And I you know, my problem was, this was a bad on me, because I didn't hit info to see what I was monitoring. But I believe this was RPM. This was map.
It says on the right.
Where? Oh, good move. Who said that? All right, top one's RPM, second one down is map, third one down is TPS, fourth is load, spark advance. So the main guys with the RPM, just to show he's dipping in the map. So this thing had some dipping problems. So I'm like, you know what I'm going to do? And then, look what happened while I was running. I had my scanner on it. Computer went to sleep, stopped talking to me. It momentarily went like this. I'm like, dude, I don't know. That computer, you sure you didn't plug the old coils back in and ruin this? He goes, John, I don't know, dude. It's crazy. I said, you know what I'm going to do? I have an H-ray scope. I'm going to monitor. That's it. I'm going to hit it with the main Magilla. I'm going to hit it. I'm going to watch the ground. I'm going to watch the auto shutdown relay. I'm going to watch the 5 volts. I'm going to watch the battery, the ignition, and the ASD feed. I'm going to just throw a net on it. Just a whole net to find out what it is. Because I'm just curious to see what it is. And do you know that when it hiccuped right here, that was a tenth of a second. So there's, for a tenth of a second, there's no way you could put any piece of equipment on this but a scope. It's literally impossible to find this without a scope. Impossible. And what I saw was this. I never lost the ground. He hung out down here. He didn't jump up. I never lost the 5 volts. The computer never shut down the regulator. I never lost battery ignition, which was white and blue. But the red, the purple, was the auto shutdown relay, because it's supposed to ground the relay. Look, you get power feed to a relay coil. It grounds, it goes, who's your daddy? Who's your daddy? Who's your daddy? Holds it down here. And then the contacts close. So it did this momentarily. And then it pulled it back down. And what's amazing to me is, I got it. The next chance I get, I want to find out how long it takes for the contacts to open the minute the relay coil is released. I got to do that test, because I got to know for myself. I'm sure Bernie knows, because he's very anal that stuff. So he's got to know the mathematical equation. Probably takes about 4 milliseconds of time to release them contacts. It probably does. I don't know. But in 100 milliseconds, yeah, a tenth of a second, it actually released. But we never lost the contact. This power feed here is for the coils and the injectors. It's ASD feed, auto shutdown relay feed. So I was like, you know what? From what I know, working on crisis for a long time, from the beginning of time, the only time a crisis will release the auto shutdown relay, if it loses crank signal or cam signal or crank cam correlation problem. So let me go check the cam sensor. I put the cam sensor up, ran it. When it released, I never lost the cam signal. Now you need to look at the signature. It's 2, 1, 4, 1, 2, 3, 2, 2. So it never lost that pattern. Did the crank sensor. Now this is normal. It dips down and dips up. That's the pattern of the crank sensor. You have to know what these patterns are supposed to look like. If not, you're going out in IATN. They're out there in a waveform library. So I never lost that. I says, you know what? There's got to be something up with this computer. It stops working. So then I did something else. This is a unique thing of having an 8-trace scope. 4-trace is nice, but I got to have the full Monty. I want to look at every single coil primary feed. I want to look at 1, 8, 4, 3, 6, 5, 7, 2. So I have blue, orange, brown, green, white, purple, red, yellow, and I go back to blue. And look at here. Look when it coughed. What happened to the coils?
Lost them all.
It stopped working. So it wasn't the fact that the ECM shut itself down. It just stopped working. It's like, dude, why did you stop working? Did I tell you to stop working? No, boss. I'm not feeling too good right now. I'm all right. I'm breathing, but something ain't feeling right. So I call up Bernie. I says, Bernie, dude, I don't know. The computer, I would think this is like an ECM reset, like it's resetting itself. But I don't know why. He goes, dude, you know what your problem is? I'm like, what? You're too much on level ground. He says, you need to get the Bernie stool and elevate yourself. You need to look below the zero line. I said, what are you talking about? He goes, do you know that when you get secondary voltage spikes from the coil? See, because when you ground something, my elastic band. You hold the band. So now, when you ground something, you're the ECM, you're grounding the coil. The minute you release it, you're going to get the spike. And that's the spike on the primary. What if the secondary followed it? Whew, that's a double hit. That's like a double fluffer nutter. That's a double hit. So what I did was I raised the pattern, raised it off the ground, because this is ground. He said, if you ever get secondary voltage coming into the ECM, you're always going to see below the zero line. Look, bang, 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 bang. Could that just be one coil? It seems like we're getting secondary spikes from quite a few coils here. So I said, Burn, this guy did swap the coil back. He goes, how about the spark plugs? I don't know. So I'm like, dude, how about the spark plugs? Oh, well, they're not factory. Well, what are they? Oh, there's some high-performance E3, how you doing, high-performance plugs. I'm like, E3, what the hell is that? I know what R2-D2 is, but what's E3? Look at this spark plug. Look at the bridge on it. It's like a delta electrode. It's got one here, one there, one back there. I got to zoom in some more. Hey, Jerry, how much do you zoom over here? Hey, this is cool zooming. It's a zoom zoomer. But I just got to zoom in as much as I can just to show you this thing. I mean, look at the head on that thing. Look at that. Look at that. Look at that thing. Do you know that he took out all these spark plugs, put in champions, and it's fixed? I'm like, oh my God, dude. You got to be kidding me. So I says, now, I want to ask you a question. You took the coils out. Why should we leave the plugs in? Well, they are a pain in the butt to take out, right? They are. But can you imagine a set of spark plugs aftermarket? This company should be ashamed of themselves. It's some kind of E3 technology. I looked at one on the internet to look it up. E3 or E-core or E. It's something to do with E. It's something to do with 3. I think it is E3. But can you imagine? And now we're dealing with aftermarket, high-performance stuff that's creating problems. And I had one dude in class last night in Massachusetts. He goes, I use those plugs in my car. He goes, after about a few hundred miles, I started having problems. My car was doing some funny stuff. And this only happens with coilover plug. Because understand that when the computer's he's in charge of that coil. He's the one working it. He's the one that's going to get zapped. And I think that these plugs should not be allowed to be used. They should be a warning. Do not use these for coilover plug. So these guys are buying these plugs. And how do you diagnose a car like this? How? I never would have dreamed that. Never. So I'm like, dude, we're burying the CCM, dude. You know that. We're burying it. We figured it out. We got a lot of time in this car. And it's the guy's fault. He's the one that bought the spark plugs. If he bought us a normal car, we can fix normal cars. It's the abnormal ones. So he's paying the abnormal charge. It's factored in. File an invoice. Abnormal charge. You got to. I'm sorry. We worked hard on that one. Very hard. That was the hardest. I still can't believe it. Still can't believe it. I wasn't right over this. Here's food for thought. Another food for thought. Okay. Left front headlight inoperative. Car got whacked, and left front headlight, not coming on. I can tell you, there's nothing wrong with the wiring. It's a brand new headlight. Right side's on, left side's off. And he's doing what he is. Hey, how you doing? All right, so I'm like, all right, well, let me go in there. It is controlled by the computer system. Because now we're programming headlights. You disconnect the battery, you may be okay, because you disconnect it, hook it back up, you could be okay. It's these guys that are not okay. That's the worst case scenario. What's the difference between that and disconnect the battery cable? What's the difference?
The low voltage.
What?
You lost memory.
How? Why are we losing memory?
Because you sucked it out.
You sucked it out. You sucked every capacitor out of that car like this. You sucked them all out. You crank a car, you have a dead battery, it's going dead. You're going to be married to steering angle sensors, headlights, child seat, occupant seat, weight, yaw sensors. These things here, they ain't the sensors they use down south. Yaw sensors. They have them in cars now. All kinds of crazy sensors. It's amazing what you're going to be calibrating now. So you lose all the calibrations on the car. So I'm like, you know what? Let me just go check it out. Understanding code definition. I understand a lot of definitions because I'm always reading them and trying to reason with them, right? So I'm over here, and here's the code I got. Oops. What happened here, Jerry? Reset. How'd that happen? All right, so you know what? All right, well, I'll do this. Wait. Part, you know, it may need a reset. Look, hey, Jerry. I did escape, dude. It's hanging up, dude. It needs like a power down. Well, I'll just do this. All right, now go back. Dude, that's, you know what, that ain't right. That stuff is not right here. Let me just this. Why don't I do this? I go previous slide. All right. Previous. All right, you know, it's probably a resizing thing. Okay, so let me just go next. Next. All right. No, but it ain't that. It's a screen. You're going to see. But look at this here. I'll zoom in over here.
Get up to the right level. Put your stool.
Look, all right. All right, I got one for you. One headlight not activated due to the risk of dazzling. Now, Walter, do you know what dazzling is, Walter? I want to know if you know what dazzling is, because I Googled it. Because, you know, dazzling was not in my mechanical terms, or my automotive technician terms. When I went to school, and watch this. So I want to know what dazzling is. So I went on the internet. Oh. And it says, to dim the vision of, especially to blind with intense light. To amaze, overwhelm, or bewilder with spectacular display, a figure skater who dazzles the audience. So I'm thinking to myself, dazzling. The computer's afraid of the driver dazzling another driver oncoming with light because it hasn't been calibrated. Go figure that one out. Why wouldn't you just put lights out of calibration? Why would you put dazzle in there? No, I think the guy wrote that was a little light in the foot. But here's the thing. I had to go in. I'm going to fix this during break time. It's Jerry's McGilla here. I have to resize it. Resize the screen.
I'll take care of it on break.
Okay. It says, after replacing any of the following, headlight assembly, lamp control module, lamp switch, or all the above, you must go in and initialize the lights. I hit it. Initialize. We'll initialize. Hit it. Initialize. We'll initialize. I'm going, well, that ain't good. So now I'm like, I like to look through a tool to see what has to offer. And you may have a tool that may not have all the functions, but at least have a tool that has all the functions. And I go in here. I saw this one thing that said, control unit reset. What do you have to lose? I hit control unit reset. I don't know what it does to the module. It probably goes, hey, back to default from factory. Then I went in and did the initialization. So I hit the button, the headlights went like this. Boop, 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 beep. done. And then I went in and created a code, the job was done. Go figure that one out. So I couldn't even perform the function test without resetting the module. And maybe it's in a book, but I like to look to see what functions are in, like, if you ever get a scan tool, read all the functions that you could do in that car, because you never know when it'll come in handy. And you don't have time to read a book on every single car, every single procedure you have to do. I'm sure it's in the manual. It says, you must perform reset prior to doing the initialization. And all it was is that it needed that done. That's all it was. We talk about reprogramming. I just want to clarify some things because a lot of guys and girls get confused on this whole reprogramming thing. So I broke it down into categories so you know what's going on with these cars. Reprogramming, when you're physically reprogramming a computer, they come without software. They communicate, but they need operating software to operate the vehicle. All right? So you're either going to get it from a disk or you're going to get it through the internet to download it into that computer through an interface. So understand that. And while you're doing this, you better make sure that the battery's fully charged, all your connections are good, your internet connection is good, because during this phase, it usually erases the boot directory on that computer. Then it loads in new boot directory and software, or does vice versa, puts the software in and puts the boot file back in. And if anything goes wrong, you will lose that computer. I mean, I lost the Ford last week, but I was told not to turn the key off, and a friend of mine helped me online. He took over my computer and actually did a different procedure, and it saved me. I don't know what happened. Something happened during the programming process. It went through. It stopped. It kicked out. I went back in. I couldn't communicate with the car, but I never shut the key off. So he made me do some other procedure called replace module instead of reprogram module, and for some reason it kicked back in again. So understand, reprogramming, you're putting in software. Reconfiguring, all you're doing is, some modules already come programmed, but you have to reconfigure them for the car. You're putting the VIN number in, so you're just putting numbers, letters in, or you're putting in options. Does the car have ABS? Does it not have ABS? Is it all-wheel drive or not all-wheel drive? And then you also have certain manufacturers, they want you to put in coding. It could be five numbers, 05321, or Ford, they'll use four digits, 16 groups of four digits. So you have to put them all in anally. CD10, 1004, DD46. And after you get done to the last row, you put the wrong one in, they'll say, sorry, you screwed up. You got to start all over again. So, and Mercedes uses 50 two-digit codes. So that's a lot of numbers to be putting in. So what they're doing is they're setting the module up to work with that car, that wheelbase, that transmission's in the car. So those coding information tells the computer what's in the car. So understand, you're not programming it, you're coding it. So understand that. Then there's initializing, where sometimes you'll get an airbag module you put in, and the body computer says, hey, how you doing? When did you get here? You're new on the block. Yeah. All right, so they shake hands. How you doing? They're initialized. I have to physically go in the tool and I have to initialize the module. So to pair them together, so they're married, where they share the same number. They have an ID number that just pairs and it's done. So understand, different process. It's not coding. You're pairing the module. Relearn procedure. These are procedures that can be lost. Or you can reset, like the throttle index, where the throttle is located, because it has to be learned. It's a learned feature. I've seen guys, maybe batteries disconnected, Nissans, you start them up, now they're going, whoa, whoa, whoa. You have to relearn the throttle. Crankshaft on GM cars. You work on the car, whatever you're doing, the battery goes dead, you have to relearn the crankshaft. So you have to sit there, start the car, rev the engine, all the way to the floor, whoa, 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 and it learns it, which is kind of stupid to me. How does a computer forget what a crankshaft is? Where are you? Are you still here? I know the car's running, but where are you? I don't understand that philosophy, but this is what they do. They relearn crankshafts. There's a procedure behind it. Fuel trim. It learns where to put the fuel. These are just learning procedures. They can be lost. They can be readapted. You can hit a button to clear all adaptations to learn them over again in case the car is not running right, or maybe you fix something and it learned to compensate for that problem. So these are relearned procedures that you have to perform yourself with your tool, if your tool can do it, because these functions can be missing sometimes. Recalibration, these are the zeroing things. These are things that can be lost when you go, such as occupant seat weight, the weight of a child on the seat, you have to zero it out, or you may have to put different weights and increments on the seat, as it tells you. Steering angle sensors, I'm getting a lot of those now. Yaw sensors, lateral sensors, and headlight motor position. So it's you can encompass it and say it's reprogrammed, but in reality, these are breakdowns, because on a Chrysler computer, it's a royal pain in the butt. I have to go in, and I have to reconfigure it. I have to put the VIN number in it. Then once I'm done, then I go on the internet with it. The internet software sees it and goes, oh, you need this software. Now I have to program it. Not done yet. Then once I program it, now I have to go into the alarm system, and I have to initialize it with the alarm system to learn to make the skin module and him line up. Then I'm still not done yet. If it has electronic throttle, I got to turn the key on, hit the button, it learns to close throttle. Then I have to hold the foot over to the floor for 5 seconds, it learns wide open throttle. That's a relearn procedure. I'm doing all this to one module. It's 4 steps. So I didn't just program it. I programmed it, I reconfigured it, I relearned it, and reinitialized it. All at the same time. You miss one step, you're done. Here's our next victim. 98 Buick Century, EVAP code 1441. And of course I go there, he erased the code on me. So I'm like, dude, what was the code? 1441. You sure? Yeah, I'm pretty sure, I think so. That's what I wrote down. I'm like, all right, so I'm going to diagnose the car today on what you saw and what's on that paper. Because don't erase codes. When you erase codes, you erase all the freeze frame. Because I want to look at freeze frame information. Do you know when this problem happened? When did it happen? What's the criteria that it set that code for? So before you start clearing codes, you have to go in and make sure you look at freeze frame and look at all the codes and make sure you write down the codes and the definition, because I need to know that information. So that's one thing, if you're going to do, make sure you document everything. So I have to look this code up. It says code P1441. Now I want to read into this code to see what it's all about. Canister purge system did not turn off when the PCM commanded purge off. I mean, I don't have to read all this other stuff, so I'm thinking, all right, the command is that it turned it off, which means it ungrounded it. So how does it know that it's the purge solenoid is normally what? An EVAP system, normally closed. It can't be there sucking all the time. It's closed when not in use. So how is the computer seeing this thing still working when it said I released it? A vacuum, what? Yeah, a vacuum sensor. A vacuum sensor in the gas tank, right? A vapor pressure sensor. I got negative 2.02 inches of mercury. It should be really zero. But it's seeing some type of vacuum back there. So like, well, the easiest thing I can do is I can go right to the EVAP line, the purge line, pull the hose off and put my vacuum gauge on it. So I have almost, I have 17 inches of vacuum all the time. So now, we can get real anal and get into the electronic end, the scanner, and hook up, activate the solenoid, and see if the driver's working, the ECM, the wiring. What's the easiest way we can separate electronics from mechanical? Unplug it. So I unplugged it. Because now, do I know whether it's a shorted wire, a bad driver, the ECM is holding on all the time? I unplug it, I still got vacuum. Now, granted, just went back to the dealership once, and that's when I unplugged it. I still have vacuum. They put a new purge solenoid in it to begin with. And this car came back a second time. They didn't resolve it. They went back to another shop. The shop was playing around with it, so I said, let me take a look at it. So I'm like, dude, I got the vacuum thing off. I said, maybe the purge could be bad. It could be. But I'm looking at everything. I'm saying, what the heck's going on here? So now, we got to think out of the box. When I was a little boy, there's the two guys, the two other kids playing in the box. You know where I was? I was outside the box. I was playing in the mud. But little I know, when I was a little boy, I was thinking out of the box. Playing out of the box, thinking out of the box. A lot of these jobs, you have to think out of the box. How can a brand new solenoid still pass vacuum? Is it defective? Something could be stuck in it. I've seen that happen. I've seen particles from the canister sticking in there. It's new, but it's working. So, yes, what do you think? What's your name?
Dennis.
Dennis, you are the man. Say it real loud.
The hoses are reversed.
Look at this. I'm going to show you something. Let's do a little zoom. Is this zoom work now, G? Oh, all right. That's good. You see that right there? C-A-N. Can. He got it in the can because he didn't read that word. I felt bad for him. I'm like, dude. And here's the dead giveaway. Do you know these little things that they have underneath the hood? What are those called? Vacuum. They're right there. It's on the hood going, pick me, pick me, pick me. I got everything you want. It's right there. Look at his face. We always see these stickers. And you know what? It says that the vacuum source is closest to the connector. And it wasn't. It was away from the connector. So all I basically did was I just took the hoses, reversed them. All right? And that's the way it should be. We can zoom in on that one too. That's the way it should be. All right? Now the feed is closest to the connector, the way it should be. All right? And look, tank pressure back down to zero. And that's it. So can you imagine that reverse lines, just guys don't think about it. You know, it went back to the dealership. He checked it because I don't get it. New part, I don't get it. But just use basic, just basic steps, baby steps, and don't get too over tech. You know, there's a word I say, don't analyze. I think they're spelled the same. Don't analyze. So just take baby steps. Here's one that'll get you. New engine swap. Not a tough job. It's a small block Chevy, right? Car comes in with a knock. You pull the engine out. You put another engine in. And it's got starting problems, right? To a point where it feels like it's out of time. And the only way you can get it running is you pull the cam sensor out. And it runs, but like chitty chitty bang bang. You know, chitty chitty bang bang. It runs just like that. And when I came there, I went, you know, I listened to it. I'm like, you know what, dude? I got this feel here. Timing. It's got to be out of time. He goes, I don't think so. I mean, it feels like it's out of time. So I'm going to tell you something. We know the suck, squeeze, bang, blow for many, many years. The good old four-cycle engine. And one thing I learned is that we have to know when is the spark happening in the cylinder. Now, when I was a kid, I used to work on lawnmowers. I would stick my finger in the hole and pull the cord and pow, I go, wow. Okay, that is compression. And then you could hold the spark in your hand if you wanted to. Some of my friends used to hold the spark in their hand. They go, ah, oh, wow. We have good spark. Really? Okay. Because we didn't have spark testers back then. So I'm thinking, now I'm trying to do this whole thing. What if you held on to the spark with this hand and you had your finger in the hole and you had the ow and the ooh, then you know the spark happened before the compression. So you got to be on time. But realistically, that stuff happens too quick. So there's got to be an easier way. And I'm going to tell you about new technology, okay? It's amazing. Do you know, I can screw this into the engine, take the spark plug out, take a pressure transducer. All it's measuring is pressure, right? It's measuring pressure. When piston comes up, it's going, here it comes. Comes up, pressure hits the transducer and makes a signal, right? And at the same time, I take the spark plug wire that came from that cylinder, I fired the plug, put a spark tester on it, I put a little inductive clamp right over this plug wire. And all this thing does, it'll create a pattern, just straight up, when the spark happens. And hence, the picture I got. This only takes a matter of 5 minutes to hook up. It's nothing. Right? Look at this. I'm going to show you. Now, this is Bernie's program. And what's nice about it is I just hook it up, hook up two things, and I run the program because it automatically sets the scope up for you. And you see these two pressure pulses? I'm going to show you something. These two pressure pulses, that's compression. And that's compression again. So would you agree from here to here is one whole vent? So that's compression, comes down on the power stroke, goes up on exhaust right here. Not much pressure in the exhaust because the valve is open, it's letting the pressure out. That's exhaust, right? Then once it blows it out, comes down on intake stroke, and again on compression stroke. I'm going to tell you that this from here to here is 720 degrees, and this is 360. Each one of these little tiny purple guys is 30 degrees, each one. So what you do is you take a cursor here, you hit one button, and this program puts everything on the screen for you. So I'm gonna anally go in here. Look, just to go, wait, up here. I want to just point to you where this thing's going here. I mean, I've done a lot of cars cranking. Normally they're like 7 degrees before top dead center cranking. Maybe 10, but mostly they're closer under 10 most of the time. He's at 30 degrees before top dead center. So I'm thinking, you know what, dude? I think the distributor's off. And he's like, dude, you gotta be kidding me, right? I've been doing Chevy motors since I was a kid. I know what I'm doing. I'm like, I'm sure you are, but you know, I don't know. Pictures tell stories here. So I'm like, well, I'm not going to offend you, but can I just check your work? I want to see it myself. And I look, I'm like, and he's got this thing all lined up. He's no joke. And understand, when you put a distributor back in, you got to know how that cap was situated. So you have to know where the base of that distributor sets in when you put it in place. So that's rule number one, knowing where to set the base. Then another thing, too, is, all right, I'm going to show you something else. All right, we come over here. He even shows me that he knows specifically on this distributor, which can be used for a 6 or 8 cylinder. It says right here, V8, says right there, well, say 6 or says 8. He put it right here. He laid it in there. And I checked it. It's on the money. I'm like, but dude, I don't get it. I said, you know what I could do? I could check. Oh, by the way, I have to back this up for a minute. I want to show you something. I looked at valve timing. I'm going to show you something else that I skipped. I'm sorry I skipped it. But doing a lot of these, I learned from Bernie that when this thing comes down, when your compression's done and the piston comes all the way down to bottom dead center, on just about every one you do, this area right here, this little curve up, I'm not getting anal here because every one I do is always the same, this little curve up, this is where the exhaust valve opens. It always opens 30 to 45 degrees before bottom dead center. This is bottom dead center right here. It always opens that area. So I'm like, you know what? Your valve timing's on the money. So I know the valve timing is good. I know it's a rebuilt motor. But I can tell you, looking at a lot of cars, I know the valve timing's on the money. So let's just look at the crank cam correlation. This is a cam signal. It goes down and up. Down, from here to here is one revolution of that distributor. This is 2 revolutions of the crank. But I want you to look at this. And this is the coil firing. I'm going to zoom in here. All right, how many times did the coil fire from here to here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But this is a 8-cylinder. Somebody got a comment?
Yeah,
now
the cam sensor is built into the distributor on that?
Yes, good question. It's built into the distributor. So the distributor is spinning one revolution, and the coil is firing 6 times. How the heck is that possible? Someone said to me last night maybe they have a 6-cylinder computer in there, but the car did come in running. And yes, I've seen that happen, but the car came in running. But look at this. Look at how many RPM signals we have here. 1, 2, 3 in one revolution of the crank. 1, 2, 3. We have 6 of these puppies in 2 revolutions of the crank. Now, I want to go look at a good known pattern because I want to see what a good pattern is supposed to be like. And Here's a program by John Thompson, I think his name is. John Thompson. Not Bernie Thompson. He's another Thompson. What's that?
He's going to have a presentation next year.
Good. Well, did he ever update this file or no?
Yeah, I think he has, John.
Well, what he did was, this guy has a lot of time on his hands. A lot. And a lot. A lot. He took waveform patterns of crank and cam for all GM cars, all Chrysler, and all Fords, and saved them into a database. So I just go grab in just by engine, year, and boom, look. We have 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I says, you know what? You know what, dude? I don't know. I'm thinking something here that's not going to be happy with. But what are you guys thinking? What? Who?
I saw it.
Are you ready? Cheater! 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 What do you think it is? Oh, I'm going to show you. I'm going to let the cat out of the bag. Ready for this one? He pulls the engine apart, the rebuilt engine, rebuilt. And you know what? I think he had to get authorization to pull it apart because they want to do it themselves. But you're like, you know what, dude? How about we do it? Save you a little time because we think that you screwed up. All right. You see this trigger wheel? See that? See that? See that? Now, we went and got a brand new trigger wheel. So we can do a little comparison. You know, like one of these things, not like the other. One of these things just don't belong. Remember that? Update you back a little bit. But here. Look at that. How many are on the one that comes with a V8? How many are on the one that comes with a 6-cylinder? They both fit. If the shoe fits, don't acquit. But look at this. The guy must have been like this. All right, 6-cylinder, 8-cylinder. 6-cylinder. Hey, Joe, what are you doing tonight? It was a Friday night. That's what he did. And then it gets shipped out, and the poor soul gets this job. How do you like that? So rebuilders are never wrong. Their parts are never bad. You're their best testers. Yes, Mr. Jerry. Really? I have to get that. It's valuable information. Having information is very valuable. It saves a lot of time. But that's pretty sad. The guy knows he's doing. He does a great job. It's clean. Clean operation. Easy in and out. And then you're married to something else that someone else did. Kind of sad, but it happens. It happens probably daily. I probably don't see enough of it out there that's happening without me going to the shops. But I'm sure it's happening a lot. Here's another one. Engine misfire. 2004 Lincoln Navigator. All right, codes PO11, PO22. All right, now the codes I got here. I got codes here. Camshaft position timing over advanced. Camshaft position timing over retarded on the opposite bank. And it's running lean on one side, rich on the other side. Do we really care whether it's running rich or lean at this point? I think we have some kind of engine, actuator, sensor problem. I mean, understand how this thing works. You're going to have 2 actuators on cam gears now, all right, that fill up with oil that are controlled by a solenoid. The solenoid has to send the oil into the cam actuator when it gets energized by the computer. The computer goes, okay, send it in. So it opens a passage, sends the oil in, then the cam actuator moves, okay? And that's how we adjust the timing on both sides. Probably a lot of things happen. We can have a grounded wire, we can have a stuck solenoid, we can have a stuck actuator, we can have a timing chain problem. There's a lot of things that can happen. Someone here brought a solenoid. Yeah, Jimmy has a solenoid he brought in. What's that?
Put it
by the car. And basically he had a problem with a rough idle, he had a code of crank cam correlation problem, and what he found was the solenoid actually fell, some screen on it fell apart, and debris got stuck in the valve, and then the oil pressure held the cam actuator in the wrong position all the time. And that was the whole problem. It wasn't the actuator, it wasn't the timing chain, but you don't know, right? So with that information, all right, I'm going to show you something. I just did basic integrity check of sensors, just to make sure coolant sensor is good, air temp sensor is good, mass airflow is reading all right. But I wanted to go after some more meat and gravy here. Bernie has an interesting tool here. It checks volumetric efficiency. volumetric efficiency. There you go. And what it does is you put in the engine size, the ambient temperature of the air, the barrel pressure, and it takes a reading of the MAP sensor, sorry, the mass airflow sensor, and throttle position. It knows how much air, because the engine's not more than an air pump. It knows how much air is being sucked into that engine. All right. So the one in red is calculated. The one in yellow is what it actually is. But here's the thing. It's not that it's low. It's what it's doing. It's doing this. Ha, 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 ha. It's breathing in and out through the mass airflow. It's going, how does air blow out? Isn't it supposed to blow, suck in? So when you get something like that, whenever I get that, that program's easy to set up. You just put the numbers in and click it. It does the rest. You have to have wide open throttle. I'm thinking either timing or caught exhaust. Because when you open up a throttle and air comes out, that's a bad thing. That's a very bad thing. I mean, I've done it with a piece of paper, rev the engine and or a dollar bill, and it's blowing out. I'm like, there's something wrong. So with that, look at this. And this is the Ford tool. It is the only scan tool out of every manufacturer that makes it so easy to find misfires. They use a histograph of engine vibration that it takes off the crankshaft oscillations. Think about it. When a piston comes up, right? Compression. Who's your daddy? Because there's a lot of compression, right? Next up, who's your daddy? Next up, who's your daddy? Who's your daddy? You know? And that's not a hard hit. It's a light hit. So it doesn't accelerate the crank. And that's what the computer picks up. It picked up cylinder 7 is a little low, number 6 a little low, number 5, and number 8. I didn't have misfire codes. Ran like crap. But what does 5, 6, 7, 8 have in common? Same bank. So I'm going, all right. Now, I'll take it a step further. I don't have to take spark plugs out with this tool. They also will check compression while you're cranking the engine. It says hold your foot wide open throttle, all right? And it measures the crank speed. Look at this. It knows that these guys have low compression. Look at it in yellow. And again, 5, 6, 7, 8. Most powerful tool I have. I can just sit there, run the engine, I know which cylinder is firing, crank the engine wide open throttle, and when you do wide open throttle, the TPS being a wide open throttle, the computer doesn't fire the injector, so you can just keep cranking. Once you crank for 10 seconds, and validate. So like, you know what, dude? Everything's pointed at one side. And we go one step further, which you guys can do with your scan tool. Do you know that you can look at, you have crank sensor, cam sensor. Then you have variable valve timing sensor, bank 1, variable valve timing sensor, bank 2. You can use these sensors to check the position of these cams. Because at idle, they should be around 0%. It's when the computer engages them. So now, if you have one at, let's see, because last night I couldn't zoom in on this, because my projector took a crap. There's 2, there's 1. I'm at 0% on one bank, and I'm at 40, 60% on the other bank. One bank is off like 60 degrees. Now, I can now use these sensors as a tool to tell me if valve timing is off. I had one time where one was at, I'm trying to think. No, one was like about 30 degrees. It was running rough, but what it was is it was the actuator. But it can be a stuck actuator. It can be. But in this case, you can have an actuator that's off to create a rough idle, but it ain't going to create low compression. So I put two, I just put them together. Like, you know what? It's all pointing to engine damage. So now we can safely rip this thing apart and let's just get the meat and gravy, see what's going on. So we dig in here a little deeper. I had them put the keyway up at 12 o'clock, and then we checked one side, and you see where the mark is here? It has to be lined up with the camshaft, right down the middle. I do the other side. Look at that puppy. He's supposed to be over here. He's way over here. And this chain had a lot of slack on it. See how the chain has moved away? See it? Look, it's not even against the guide no more. Yeah, something happened over here. Tension or something happened, and this thing jumped. But and you see right here? See right here, these little the little trigger wheel for the cams. But how nice is it now that we can look at a data and just look at PIDs and go, this cam time's off. But now you got to put, now you have to decide whether it's mechanical with a chain problem, or is it an actuator problem, or is it a hydraulic or electrical problem. So I'm telling you how I did it, is I saw four missing cylinders. You could have done a compression test too. And by the way, this is a common problem on that right bank. Very common. It takes a crap on that side. And here's my last case study on hybrids. Let me tell you something. Hybrids, you gotta be real careful with, man. And whenever I work on these hybrids, I put my gloves on because I don't want any problems. And the one dude that had worked with me, man, he was just getting on my nerves. He was nervy and jerky. I mean, I'm a nervous guy to begin with. He was getting me nervous. He's going back there, fiddling. I'm like, dude, stay away from the car. Let me diagnose it. We'll see what's going on. And he runs back again. Dude, you have no gloves. You're playing with stuff. And the thing is hooked up live. It's all exposed. And you're back there. Just stay away from the car. He keeps going back there. I'm like, you know what, dude? How about you go back there when I'm away and gone? Then you could die afterwards. I just want you to die while I'm here. But I'm just telling you, I didn't understand him. I really didn't. I felt bad for him. He's a nice guy, but he was getting my nerves. But look at this. I hook up the tool. Now the what's nice about the Toyota tool is it'll go in and it'll ping all these modules. It knows that all these modules could be available for the car. And when it gets done, it'll turn all the ones that are available into white, and all the ones with an asterisk mark are either not responding or they're not on the car. So it's doing a call test to see who's here. Once it does that, it takes all the modules, and I don't like this, they should put this in black, because red means bad. But over here, it means good. I don't get it. But what they do is they highlight all the problem areas in yellow, all right? And at the same time, I'm online, it tells me if there's any updates for the hybrid computer or the engine computer. See, it says no, 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 no. So I went on the network to see if there's any updates. But I'm concerned with this code, P-O-A-D-O. I think it is, can't see it too well. I think it's P-O-A-D-O. I don't know what that code is, so I'm going to go into the system. And what that code is, all right, it's saying high voltage system interlock circuit high. Well, I want to know more about it. And all I got to do is this button here says TIS search. Now I'm on the internet. I highlight this code, hit TIS search. It'll go on their network and check everything on that network dealing with that code. See it? It pulled up, there's no service bulletins, and it pulled up all repair information that I need for that. So I just click on one of them just to see what's going on, because I want to learn about what that code's all about. All right? I go in, and it tells me up here, it gives me description first, because we have to know what it's all about. If the HV control ECU detects the operation of the safety devices, removal of the service plug grip and inverter cover while the vehicle stopped, all right, it will shut down the system main relays. So that service plug in the back, and there's another service plug on another section of the car a little further down back, which I'll show you. I have a diagram of it. If either one of those switches are open, it won't allow the car to start. So they're safety plugs. So I'm thinking maybe it got damaged, maybe it's not seated right, I don't know. But if you look a little further here, it gives you a diagram. You scroll down and there's the diagram. They want you to fix these cars. So they give you circuit description first, and then they give you a diagram. And you see the service plug? That's the battery plug that you pull out by the high voltage battery. Then the other one's by the inverter. It's an interlock switch. So what do you think the computer's running through this circuit to ground? Bias voltage or reference voltage to check the integrity of the circuit. If it sees 5 volts and knows you're open somewhere, you're done. So basically, if there's something wrong with this plug, this car ain't going to start. So next move, right? So I have a diagram, and also it gives me a heeds warning, right? Like I told the guy. It says here, it says, before inspecting the high voltage system, take safety precautions to prevent electrical shocks, such as wearing insulated gloves and removing the service plug grip. After removing the service plug grip, put it in your pocket to prevent other technicians from reconnecting it while you're servicing the high voltage car. Hey, look what Joe left off. Let me put it back in. You better put it in your box, lock it up, because Joe may think he's doing you good, but meanwhile he's doing you bad. So it says right there, Put it away. After this, get the service plug, wait at least 5 minutes before touching any of the high voltage connectors. So you have to wait 5 minutes for everything to power down so it's safe to work. And it says wear insulated gauze before performing the following. So these are precautions that they put in there because they don't want to see you get hurt. So, and it even shows you a picture of the plug. And if you look at this plug, in this plug, there's a little two-pin connector, all right, that's part of that latching device. So the latching device connects big main terminals in the battery, but this other little device, which the wires could be broken, there's two little wires in it, that guy there, well, actually there's two terminals that join two wires on that housing. That device there is going to allow those two wires to connect, okay? So I'm like, all right, let me just go back here and I'll just look at this plug. Now, if you look at this system here, okay, I got it. See, these buttons are too small. But you see how this is all exposed? And I was afraid of that guy going back there touching things because he was all like touchy-touchy. He's all like, ooh, I'm just touchy-touchy. So, but he had no gloves on. But this is the lock mechanism right here. So this lock has to slide up and pull out. Okay? So when I was checking it, you'll see, I had my gloves on. All right? No glove, no love, because you're gone forever. There's no more love. So I checked the integrity of this thing. And you know what? It was not fully down. It was down, but not enough. So he pulled it out, he put it in, and latched it, but he didn't hear the click. He didn't feel the click. He didn't go far enough down. And it can happen. Because you don't know. Maybe you won't force it. So he latched it, but wasn't fully latched in. So I just pulled out, just inspected, because I want to make sure, I pulled out, I want to make sure that the two little prongs weren't damaged or whatever. So then I probably seated it, and there it is. It's seated lower to the floor, right there. So now you're plugged in, and then basically when you're done with those cars, see, once you repair that, then the computer has to go through a check three times. You shut it off, you start it up. You attempt to start it up. It checks everything. You shut it off. Usually on three attempts, it will eventually start. But what I usually do with the scan tool, I go in there and I cleanse it of all error codes. Because if there's error codes in there, it wants to recheck the system. But I'll just clear the codes, and on the first start, it'll usually start up for me. But if those codes are in there, it may take 2 to 3 starts of trying it for it to start up. But, you know, there's safeties built into these cars. You have to just be very careful when you're working on them and read information. Information is always going to help you. So I hope that all the information I gave you guys tonight, guys and girls, is going to help you down the road to think a little different. And if you run across one of these jobs, think about me and say, you know what? I seen a John's class and it paid off. So I hope you really enjoyed tonight's class. All right?